side, we have ties that can be major and minor, okay? And on the other side, we have ties that can be perfect, all right? And what's important to realize on this is that if the interval, like for instance, a second or a third, right? We could talk major, minor there, and that was fine. But what seconds and thirds can never be is perfect. They will never be perfect intervals, okay? So when you start talking about quality, and if you're talking about a fourth or a fifth, fourths and fifths go over here. Unisons and octaves also fall into this category. Okay, so this is their territory. Okay, it's a perfect world. And then over here in the major minors, we have seconds, we have thirds, we have sixths, and we have sevenths. So these never cross-pollinate in their most like common form. Okay? Generally, if we see a fourth or a fifth, we're kind of expecting perfect intervals. That's kind of just the expectation. If we see seconds and thirds, we're expecting major-minor interval. That's just our expectation, okay? Now, in the middle, and this is where there is some overlap, we have these intervals that are called augmented and diminished, okay? And any interval can be augmented or diminished, all right? So this can apply to any of our numbers, but specifically, this will never apply over there, and that will never apply over here. That kind of makes sense? Now, these are less common. We don't expect these as often, okay? So when I say fourth and fifth, we're not usually going to be thinking augmented diminished. When I say second and third, sixth, seventh, we're not usually thinking augmented diminished. That's kind of a specialty thing. And we see it sometimes, and we don't see it other times, okay? So, the reason we have to have this conversation is when we talk about fourths and fifths, we're going to start by talking about what's the most common, which is the perfect, okay? So, I'm just going to start out by looking at a couple of things. Now, the primary difference between perfect intervals and major-minor intervals is, do you remember when we were over there in the thirds and we were saying, if I go up three in a major scale from root to three or from tonic to three, then I'm going to see a major third. Right? Fourths and fifths are perfect because it doesn't really matter what key you're in. The tonic to the four and the tonic to the five are going to do the same thing. Make sense? So if I was in C major, I would see C to F, that's tonic to subdominant, right? If I was in C minor, I'd see C to F, that's tonic to subdominant. It doesn't change. Okay? But so we're going to just look at, again, trying to measure the baseline of interval. Okay? So let me sit here and say, if I'm in treble clef, and I write a C, and I go up 5, and any C key, whether it's major or minor, really isn't going to change anything. I go up 5, I say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's in the key, so this is a perfect fit. Okay? Now, visually, a pattern you guys need to get used to if you don't know this, line to line, but skipping a line, is a fifth, okay? And consequently, space to space, but skipping a space, is also a fifth, right? Now, when I just say fifth, what I have not identified, remember, is quality. I have interval, and I have the quality of that interval. So right now, I know it's a fifth just because I can look at it and tell, right? But I have to go in and make some assessments to figure out quality. So if I go to D major, what's my key of D major, guys?
Two sharps.
Two sharps, F sharp, C sharp, right? So I go up D, E, F sharp, G, A. So this is in that key, okay? This is a perfect fifth. And I come over to E, what's in my key of E? Four sharps. So I got F sharp, C sharp, G sharp, and D sharp. I go up 5, E, F sharp, G sharp, A, B. And since I already did the thinking about the key, I know that this one's perfect because I found it in the key, right? All right. I move over to F. F has what in it?
One flat.
One flat. B flat, so F, G, A, B flat, C. Okay. And then this one's also a perfect fifth. And again, that's what I'm looking for, right? one sharp, G, A, B, C, D. So that one's pretty easy. A has how many sharps?
Three.
F sharp, C sharp, G sharp, so E natural. So far these are all perfect fits, okay? And it's easy to remember these, by the way, because it's just natural note. Like, at the bottom's a natural note, the top's a natural note. It's not, you know, with the thirds, we kind of had to use some manipulation to get them to all be major and all be, you know. This one, just, everything just looks like a natural note. The only change is going to be this. When I get over to B, B has five sharps in it, right?
Yes.
So one of those sharps is going to be F sharp. So the final one here, B to F sharp, I have to have that sharp for it to be a perfect fit. Okay? Without that. And we saw that in the circle of fits as well. We weren't talking about qualities of intervals, but we were going up a perfect fifth every time. Okay, we want to go back there. Every time we went up or down, we were going by perfect fifth, not by just number fifth. Okay? So these are all the perfect fifths, and they're super easy to memorize, right? C to G, D to A, E to B, F to C, G to D, A to E, B to F sharp. Stay awake, don't get complacent. Okay? Now, I'm going to come over here and I'm going to look at now my fourths, okay? I'm going to, again, I'm going to start on C, okay? But it's the same process. I'm just going up four, and again, with the perfects, major and minor key really is irrelevant. I can do it all in minor keys. Let's do that, okay? So I'm going to come over here and I'm going to say, okay, I'm on C. C minor has how many flats in it?
Three.
E flat, E flat, A flat. Right, very good, very good. So I'm going to go C, D, E flat, F. And I can check against C major too, and we get the same result. Okay. And then I come up to the next note, so now I'm looking at D. Now, here's the thing, guys. A little ledger line check work. I don't need a line below this one. Remember this, because I'm going below. All I need is whatever the placeholder is above it so that I know what it is. So if you were to draw a line below this, you'd actually be wrong. Okay? You're making it weirder by doing that. Not more clear, but less clear. Okay? So D minor, what's in that key?
One flat.
One flat. Very good. So I got B flat, so D, E, F, G. Perfect fourth. And again, I can check that against D major and use the same result. Gonna come over here to E. E minor has what in it? One sharp. E, F sharp, G, A. So there's another perfect fourth. And then coming up to F, F minor, what's in that one? Four flats. So B flat, E flat, A flat, D flat. So when I go up this one, F, G, A flat, B flat, there's that. Okay. Yeah.
Why was it that when you switched to the fourth, you started accessing the minor?
I just do it because we don't think about minor keys as often, so I just want to make y'all think about it.
Oh, okay.
It doesn't matter either way. You could do it with majors, but often we do so much major work that we neglect the minors and people get rusty on them, so I'm just doing it for work. Okay.
And yeah. Did you just write down what keys those are in just for reference?
Yeah. So basically, anytime you do this, Justin, it's going to be the lowest note is the key.
Oh. Okay.
Does that make sense? So whenever I move over C, D, E, F, G.
Oh, okay.
I would just use that as the key zone.
Okay, thank you.
Coming over here, G minor, how many flats, guys?
Two.
Two, very good. So I have B flat, E flat, which means I'm going to go G, A, B flat, C. And I come over here, A minor has no sharps, no flats, right? So that one's just going to go straight up A to D. And then B minor has two sharps. So you notice, if I'm just looking at, I use the keys to find the information, right? That's where I start, so that we have a consistent principle. But once you have it, the data doesn't change. Everybody follow this? So like, I don't care what key I'm in. If I see F and B flat, that's a perfect chord. Does that make sense? You could be playing in, you know, C major, and somebody plays an F and then asks you to add a B flat. It's still a perfect chord. Is that, so the when you see this, regardless of the key zone you're in, once you know perfect chord, it never changes. And that's the part that we have to start here so that we know the why, but immediately we need to get to just know it, because nothing else really matters. Does that make sense? You can always go back and tell yourself why, but 2 + 2 = 4 is not a why question for anyone. It's just a, that's just what it is, kind of thing. You know what I mean? And so that's the goal of all of this rigmarole, is I want you to know why, so you're not sitting there going, I know information, but it's not tethered to anything. But in your actual life in class, nice, in your actual life in class, we need to make sure that we work through this as a memorization exercise more than anything else. Okay? So, you're going to come through here. This is also super freaking easy to memorize because almost all of them are natural notes all the way across the board. Where is it different? F to B flat. You notice both times this was a problem for us. You see that this one required modification, this one required modification. That's because these specific two notes, if you deal with just the naturals, are a naturally occurring tritone. Okay? And a tritone evenly divides the octave. Okay? And it gives us a very tense, specific sound. So let's go listen to one. Tritone stands for two different intervals. A tritone stands for an augmented fourth, and it stands for a diminished fifth. Okay? So, I've got two different interval qualities. The reason that we use the term tritone, especially when you get into ear training, if Bell's behind the keyboard and he plays a tritone, you will not be able to tell whether he played a diminished fifth or an augmented fourth because the number is the same. Or the, not the number, the sound is the same. Make sense? So if I take, let's take the idea of an augmented fourth. So I say D to G is a perfect fourth, right? So if I make it a half step bigger, I get an augmented interval. Okay, so D to G sharp is an augmented fourth. But if I write G sharp as A flat, have I changed this sound at all? This is that inharmonic thing we talked about early in class, right? So if I play D to A flat, well, you know now D is the same note. This is really the same sound. So I'm not going to get a different sound, but on the score, it would look different. Does that make sense? So if I were to tell you, hey, it's a 5, then you would know, well, it's a diminished fifth. If I were to tell you, hey, it's a 4, oh, well, it's an augmented fourth. But most of us don't experience music like that. We hear it, and we can say, oh, that's a tritone. You follow me? If I know it's a tritone, I know that sound. When I have just my ears to use, that's the term that I use because I don't know what the number is. When I have the score, I have an opportunity to assign, oh, augmented fourth, diminished fifth, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, great.
Okay, I guess that might be confused. Is it just the modification that makes it augmented and diminished, or is it, like, to make it a tritone, or is it?
Yeah, I think, let me go back a level, and we'll talk about something I didn't address already, okay? So. When we deal with augmented and diminished, okay, in the context of fourths and fifths, that's all I really want to talk about. We'll get to these in a minute, but I don't want augmented and diminished, okay? Just here. If I go one half step bigger than perfect, I get augmented, okay? So y'all might want to get that one down. So if I go bigger than perfect, I should say half step, we got it. to be specific about that. Half step bigger. And you notice I didn't say higher. It's just bigger because it's expanding and shrinking. It's not about tall. It's about this. Or I could even do it this way. We just generally think.
Okay.
So a half step bigger than perfect is augmented. So then what do you think diminished is going to be? It's going to be a half step smaller, right? Okay. So what ends up happening, Brandon, is if I augment the fourth, I've made it the same as if I had diminished to the fifth. Does that make sense? So if I were to take, here's the treble clef, I know that C to F is perfect. So the next thing would be C to F sharp. That would be perfect fifth, or perfect fourth, excuse me, augmented fourth, right? And then if I were to take the fifth version of that, F sharp is G flat, right?
Mm-hmm.
So then this is a diminished fifth. But then if I just go one half step bigger, G flat up a half step is G, right? So then I would have my perfect fifth. These two don't sound any different, right? But if I saw that, I can't call it a diminished fifth because it's not a fifth. Forward, right? I can call either of them a tritone though, because the tritone's like, you know, in geometry when you have like classifications for shapes, right? Like rectangles and squares aren't always the same thing, but you know, umbrella, right? Four sided object. So this is what that is. Okay. Woo! So I'm sorry if that's like, if you're like in the front row, it's like, whoa, dude, that's too much, I'm sorry.
We appreciate it over here.
Okay. I'm going to have surgery, have my eyes, you know, open wider so I can make contact, you know, better in the back rows. Okay. So, let's mess with these, okay? What I'm going to do is I'm going to change them in some way. And then I'm going to ask each of you, in turn, a specific question about it, and you'll tell me what I did, okay? So, doesn't mean that I'm going to make it augmented or diminished, by the way. I'm going to keep it the same, right? So just be aware of that. All right. So, what's the quality shield? Anybody need to know why it's perfect fifth? And it's okay if you do. Okay. We established that C and G are perfect, right? Did I change the distance when I made them both go down a half step?
No.
I didn't because both of them went down, right? If I'd only changed one, then I would have altered the distance.
Yeah.
But since what I'm interested in is not what the notes' names are, but what their distance is between each other, mm-hmm. nothing changed in that sense. And that's all I'm interested in right now. So this is the same interval, it's still perfect. Okay? Richard. Contracted the interval, right? I took this one stayed the same, and then this one came up. That makes it smaller by half step, right? So then you align. sharp day is going to be diminished. Okay? So yeah, that's the right process. All right. Let's see. Andrew. Yes. This is an augmented fit. And again, what I have to work on, the assumption that I have to start out with, is that I've got a perfect fit E to B, right? We had that already written down, so we knew that that was perfect, okay? And if, when I take the bottom note and I decide to drop the bottom out by a half step, did I expand or contract that interval? I expanded it, right? So then a half step bigger than perfect is going to be that augmented. Okay, so that's what I'm seeing here. All right. Daisy.
Perfect fourth,
good. Yeah, perfect fifth. F to C is perfect. Nothing really changed. I just have new symbols in front of both. Okay. Let's see, Dalton. Perfect fifth, right? It doesn't matter if these are double sharps. Like, don't be tripped out by that. You know G to D is perfect. G double sharp to D double sharp is still the same amount of alteration, right? Okay. What that looks like. All right.
Augmented.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Raise the top note a half step there. I created a bigger interval, so augmented fifth. Justin.
That would be augmented.
It's augmented as well, right? It's a weird thing to look at, isn't it?
Yeah.
You see the flat and the sharp?
Mm.
This stuff can happen, though. Right? Like, don't sit there and go, well, that's never going to happen to me. No, it could happen to you, right? G minor is a perfect example of something like this happening, right? G minor's got B flat and got E flat. We generally raise the seventh scale degree. So you're playing the scale, essentially. You have that augmented fifth right there in the scale, okay? So this one's going to be an augmented fifth. All right. Diminished fourth, okay? Now, I'll be honest, this is probably the least common one, okay? Out of all the ones we're looking at right now, diminished fourth is the least likely to happen. But again, it doesn't mean it won't ever happen, it's just less common. It's more of an exercise thing for you right now. If you see this, though, and this is where we get into inharmonic stuff, and sometimes it bleeds over in ways that feel unnecessary, this is gonna sound like a major third, okay? And that's important. Because if you see this and you're in an ensemble, especially if you're a singer in an ensemble, right, some kind of choir, and you see that, you want that jump to be a fourth after a lot of training, right? You think, oh, Christmas tree, can you see this, right? But this isn't, oh, Christmas tree, this is Ding Dong in reverse, okay? So you're looking at it, and it's not like literally like a doorbell, right? So if you look at this and you think fourth, 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 your placement's going to be wrong because you don't want to place it in that spot, right? If you know that sounds like a major third, it just can't be called that, then you know where to put it, okay? And so that's what this is about. I cannot call this a major third because it's not a third, right? I can know that it's going to sound like one, but I can't call it that. And that's where we kind of get it all correct. Yeah?
If you were to double sharp, like a fifth, would it just raise it to a sixth at that point?
Yeah, what you're dealing with there, when you get into stuff that's like, that is just to be like augmented plus, right? We don't really use that. So C to G double sharp has no leading purpose, so you would never use it. And so even though theoretically I could write those two notes and it wouldn't be weird, there's very little context where that is any use to me. So it's not something you're gonna have to, that's a good question. But it's not something you have to worry about that much, just because the music, we don't have chords that move like that, so we don't bother studying. Does that make sense? Pretty much everything we're talking about here is ways you can function, and if it doesn't have a function, you just gotta throw it. All right, let's see. Adam. and four.
Very good.
Nothing really changed, so it stayed the same.
All right.
Save. What was a perfect?
Perfect was with a flat. Oh,
okay.
So it's augmented.
Yeah, it went the other way, right? This one, by taking away the flat, I actually expanded the interval, right? Because that it was here, now it's here. Okay. It's a half step there. This is augmented. Fall. That's okay. It's G to C flat.
G to C flat. Augmented fourth.
What was the perfect fourth? Did I start off?
Diminished fourth.
There you go. Other way, right? It shrunk. So we're going to call it from diminished. This is all we're doing with intervals, right? But the main thing is, if you have it memorized, if you know what all your naturals are, then this is not that weird, because you're just looking at it saying, okay, I know what this is, stone cold. That's not a problem for me. Okay, well, it got changed, it's a half step smaller, therefore it's a diminished fifth, right? And so everything plays off of that initial basic knowledge, as opposed to saying, well, I gotta memorize 21 perfect fifths, and then I gotta memorize 21 diminished fifths and 21 augmented. You know, I haven't tracked crazy. Okay? So this is where I want to put it right now. The fifths are so easy, because what's the only one that isn't gonna be natural to natural? B to F, okay? Either direction, up or down. If it's F to B or if it's B to F, that's the one that needs modification. Paul, you had a question?
Well, I think you're answering it now.
Okay.
Actually, Professor, if I may?
Yeah, no.
So you just gave the example of the only exception for perfect fifths, in which one needs an accidental is B to F or F to B.
Mm-hmm.
In perfect fourths, there's just one exception there as well, right?
Yeah.
So when you think about memorizing this stuff, that's the part that you're talking about memorizing, is just that one exception for each of them?
I mean, you could boil it down to that too. You just have to realize all the other ones are natural. Like, you have to know what the other ones are, too. But they're not that hard to memorize, because it's perfect. I mean,
right.
Like, if I know the principle, then I know what all these are.
Right.
Right? So then I would just have to be aware that if I saw that, I would have to know that that's diminished. Because what I should expect there for a perfect fifth is an F sharp above that B. Right? So if that F sharp isn't there, it's a half step smaller, I know that's diminished. Does this make sense? The fifths and the fourths are easier than the thirds, because the thirds require so many different sharps to be added for you to get it, that you have to spend some time looking at them, right? This one, if I know the natural notes, equal it, pretty much takes care of itself.
So is that like any key? So like, it doesn't matter what key you're in, the only exception
I want to say yes, but there's so many possible ways that that question could be manipulated to say no, that I'm a little concerned about drawing an overall principle. So let's talk about this. I don't care what key you're in, if it's a natural note to a natural note, unless it's B and F, then it would be a perfect.
Okay.
Right? So if I was in the key of G, for instance, just because that exists, does not change the fact that this is a perfect fit. Right? The key doesn't alter the quality, right? But let's go over here. Let's say that I'm in this key, right? And I write that. Now, what do you know about key of G? see this, that's not an F natural anymore, right? That's an F sharp. So what is this interval called? It's going to be a diminished interval, right? So that's the one thing you have to carry with you as you deal with this, right? Is the key signature could alter what you're looking at as a fifth, depending on if the accidental hits it or not, right? So you basically have like crapshoot bingo in the key of G, right? You're saying, okay, G to D is unaffected, A to E is unaffected. B to F sharp is actually made perfect by the key. C to G, D to A, E to B, F sharp to C, U to G.
So the key signature can change these and make them smaller. The key signature can make these diminished and augmented.
Yes, depending on which ones you're dealing with, okay? So let's do a, based on this line of questioning, I want to give you something else. Might not. You're like, yikes, don't do it. It's going to get so much worse. Okay. Let's take any key, not just C major, right? But here's E flat major, okay? If I take this, then I'm gonna add for emphasis all the accidentals that are there. Okay, we don't need them. Technically, then it's going to have rest. I know if E and B is perfect, that's perfect, right? Because they're both flat. I come over here and I say, F and C, well that's perfect. G and D, that's perfect as well. A flat to E flat, well that's perfect as well. B flat to F, well remember I needed B to go to F sharp. So if B goes down to B flat, F sharp goes away. Yeah, I haven't actually changed the distance again, so this is still perfect. Okay? Come over here, C to G, well I know that's perfect. Now I get over here and I have D to A flat. Well, what I know about it, this is that it should be D to A if I wanted it to be perfect, right? And since it's A flat to half step smaller, so it's a diminished fifth. Okay? Now, and here's where we start talking about major keys only. Okay? In any major key, if you go to the seventh scale degree of that key and you find the fifth above it, it'll be a diminished fifth every time. Okay? So if you were in the key of B, and you go up to 7, so B, C sharp, D sharp, E sharp, F sharp, G sharp, A sharp, and then you find a fifth above A sharp, it's going to be E. A sharp to E is diminished. Okay? If you're in the key of D flat, D flat, E flat, F, G flat, A flat, B flat, C is your seventh scale degree, C to G flat is diminished. All the other ones in any key, if you build a fifth off any other scale degree, it would be perfect. It's always that seventh scale degree that creates a diminished fifth in a major key. Does that kind of make sense? It's not necessary for you to know that right now, like that's not going to be on your test or like change your life, but if you're curious, that's what it is.
So that B flat to F, that's an augmented fifth?
B flat to F is actually perfect because B to F is diminished, right? So if I take, F and this B, and then I made that B flat, what happened to the other one? Well, it started out as diminished, but B to F is diminished. So if I expand that a half step, I get perfect. Does that make sense?
Do you mean
that
it's like a chord because B flat to F,
do
you add a
chord? Yeah, you can do that. Yeah. If you already can think about that one as well. So let's listen to some fifths. Here's C major. I'm just playing the scale, right? You hear how the quality change there? That's the 7. Here's your diminished. Let's do E. It changed again, right? That very last one, if you go a fifth over E, you always get the diminished. Tense.
Dissonant.
Dissonant, right? I see this word dissonant, that means any interval that I hear and I'm like, ooh, that one kind of bites. Okay? The most obvious example of that's gonna be a half step. A half step is always gonna sound dissonant, right? So when you play that, let's listen to what one of those sounds like. They're so close together. Not what we do today, okay? So I would call a third consonant But if you're writing counterpoint, it's technically dissonant, okay? But that's way in the future. I just don't want you to roll into your senior class and think that you know what's happening and then all of a sudden get the bug pulled out from under you. Because it will happen. Hopefully you'll have a better counterpoint teacher than I had. So far, so good? Okay. Now, we talked about what happens to a perfect interval if we make it bigger or smaller by half step, right? We know that process now, okay? But let's talk about what happens to a major interval if I make it smaller, okay? So if a major interval gets smaller by half step, actually, I get smaller by half step, what happens to a major interval? You actually already know this. It's minor, right? So the first stop, the thing that's important is over here in the perfect world, the second I'm not perfect, I immediately go to augmented or diminished. That's the only option I have, okay? But with major intervals, if it gets a half step smaller, your first stop is minor, okay? Now, if I want to get even smaller than minor, let's go a half step smaller. So that would be something like C to D double flat. Okay? That's very small, right? In fact, that's actually technically going to be a unison if you listen to it, right? But I can't call it a unison because of the context here, okay? So if I go smaller than minor, what do you think I'm going to get? Diminished, okay? So like we said, the augmented and diminished can apply either way. That's what happens once you go smaller than minor, then you're diminished. The other side of this, though, is if I go half step larger than major, what am I going to get?
Augmented.
That's when augmented happens for these, okay? So it's possible to get augmented seconds, thirds, sixths, sevenths. It's possible for those to be augmented. It's also possible for them to be diminished. But it's usually a little bit more of a process to get there, and it's not as common of a thing to see, okay? If I were to augment to seventh, let's say that I have C to B. I'm just going to tell you this now. C to B is a major seventh, okay? If I were to raise it a half step, that's technically now an augmented seventh, but what is B sharp to our ear? C, right? So you're going to hear a perfect octave. So stuff like this, even though you, every now and then you will see it, is not as useful, so it's less common. Okay? You'll see stuff like this when specific things are trying to be accomplished in music, but it's not like, no one's going to ask you to play a scale and write that, because it's kind of dumb, you know? Now, the flip side of that is, with sevenths, a diminished seventh is actually a really common thing to see. So even though you might not think it, and even though this looks weirder, that is actually something you'll deal with quite a bit. This is something you'll deal with not very often at all. Okay? So be prepared to use augmented and diminished on major minor type intervals, but it will be less frequent than the major minor type. Okay, same thing with augmented and diminished. Look at all the intervals we wrote that were perfect, and then how many was diminished? Just the one, right? And that's kind of what you're going to see as you work through this. Okay?
So we basically hear the diminished seventh at a major six.
Yes. Okay. Although, yes. I'm just going to say yes for now. If you really want to know, I'll tell Why is it double flat? Okay, if I were to, what I was just talking about Kurt here is, if you call that an A, right, like a major six sound, if I call it A though, can I call it a seven?
No.
So that's why I use double flat. It's literally just what I needed to do. Okay? Now, here's a little trick. You know how I said that sixths and thirds are the same thing, just in reverse? Seconds and sevenths, fifths and fourths? Well, if you do that, everything always adds up to nine. So a unison and an octave are the same thing, but spread apart. Does that make sense? So unison would be the note to itself. That's a unison. This is an octave. Okay? And you notice the notes are the same, but now they're doing this, okay? 1 plus 8 is 9, okay? If I were to take F to G and reverse the direction of it to where F is above G, not below it, I took a second and I made it a 7, which again adds to 9, okay? And then if I took F to A, which is a 3rd, and I took A to F, which is a 6th, again, 9, and then if I took F to B, which even though it's, I know this is technically an augmented 4th and diminished 5th, but the number is the same, 4 and 5 is 9. Okay? And there's a fun little, like little equation thing that happens. If an interval is perfect, and you flip its order, it stays perfect. Okay? So if I add F to F, which is a perfect unison, and I spread it out, I would get a perfect octave. So the perfects stay perfect, but then the numbers equal 9. Okay? So if I had a perfect 4th, and I took those same notes and I flipped them, I'd get a perfect 5th. Because perfects stay perfect, and 4 and 5 is 9. Okay? So I come over here, and what am I looking at here? I'm looking at a major, okay? So the perfect stayed perfect, but majors flip to minors, okay? So F to G is major, but if I flip it, G to F is minor, okay? So majors turn to minors, minors would turn to majors, okay? 2 and 7 equal 9. I come over here, let's do it in reverse, let's make this a minor third start, and then we can see it in process. So if I start with a minor third and I flip it, A flat to F is going to be a major sixth because I've changed the order. So minor becomes major, 6 and 3 is 9. And then with augmented and diminished, they flip as well. So this starts out as an augmented fourth, and when I flip it, it becomes a diminished fifth. So, for instance, anything you know now, like if you say, okay, I know that G and B is a major third, if they're thirds, right? But what is B and G? Okay, well, G to B was major and it was a third, so B to G is minor and it's a sixth. You see how that conversion works? This is consistent all the time. If you took a perfect fifth, B flat to F, well, if you want to find the fourth version of that, flip it. Perfect, stay perfect, so perfect fourth is 5 and 4 9. And that's why we always had trouble with that B and F interval. We saw that we had to make an alteration because B to F is a diminished fifth or a tritone. And so if I flip it, diminished becomes augmented, 5 and 4 is 9. So I'm always going to get that tritone sound because the conversion thing, you know, is always consistent. Yeah?
Tritone. Something we would call dissonant?
Yeah, well, definitely. Yeah.
Is there generally pretty widespread consensus on what we would call dissonant and incompetent as far as year 2020 goes?
Yeah. Yeah, second, sevenths, and tritones are dissonant. Third, sixths, fourths, fifths are all constant.
So is the tritone what's called the devil's tone or something?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I think it's an urban legend. There's not really any backing up data for this, but in the Middle Ages and the Renaissance, they thought the tritone was like the devil in music. So they would not write it for it wasn't supposed to be written in church music because it was edgy. So, say what? Yeah, exactly. It's the same thing because low priam mode actually features a tritone. That's kind of their problem with it, right? So, and there may be some basis for some kind of use of that, but I was taught it was fact, and I think it's a little bit more of a story, that we all enjoy telling. But what it is the tritone helps us in modern music set up home. It helps point to it. But if you listen to Gregorian chant, you ever hear harmonies? No, you just they just stop one day, right? Like, you know, literally 3 days later, they decide they're going to sing Yah on their Alleluia and then walk away, right? and so that idea of creating these harmonies, they kind of spun it into the, well, maybe they were avoiding the tritone because that would have helped them get there, right? I don't really think it was that. I think it was just a form everybody's used to, right? But yeah, that's just my opinion. But yeah, some people call it the devil in music, which is kind of a fun little, you know, if you want to draw pentacles or pentagrams or whatever, you know, right, right, you might get it sound here. Does that make sense? Sweet. Okay. So we're gonna start using these. I'm gonna do a couple of quizzes over these, okay? So like when you come back Monday, we're gonna have a quiz and I am gonna grade it, okay? This one will go in the grade book. Alright? But it'll start out, what I'll be doing is giving you literally just letters and telling you write a major third above these letters. Or giving you, you know, diminished fourths above this letter. So if I give you D, you write G sharp because that's an augmented fourth. We're not going to do them on the staff because I want you to be able to think about it as letter names as well, where it doesn't only work if you're looking at the staff.
I'm not going to be able to hear you with this music that's happening out here. Can I ask them to turn it down? Or?
We're almost done. Okay. So there's music. Am I deaf or is it like I'm really?
No, I hear it.
Okay. It's barely awful. So.
Yeah, so you're just getting the
air. From over there.
Yeah, I know. I'll throw you a football or something. All right. So, we're just gonna, if you didn't get it, we're gonna have a quiz on Monday over different interval types. I'm going to keep it to seconds, thirds, fourths, and fifths, okay? We're not gonna get into sixths and sevenths just yet, okay? But it will be all the qualities, major, minor, augmented, diminished, perfect. Any of those are on the table. Sound good? All right. This is chapter 2 in your book if you'd like to.